We should get friendly. My name's Satchmo.
All me. Why not take all of me, baby? Oh, can't you see? I'm no good without you. Oh, baby, taking limbs. I want to lose them. Oh, baby, take my arms. I'll never use them. Oh, baby, your goodbye. Left me with eyes that cry. Oh, I gotta go on, dear, without you. You took the part that once was mine. Oh, why not take off, oh, baby?
He was a man who was truly universal. He was loved in Africa. He was loved in Europe. He was loved in Japan, everywhere he went. Not just because he smiled, he was loved because the sound of that horn was a pure spiritual essence, the sound of America and the freedom that it is supposed to offer.
Of the way he played, the way he looked, his stage manner, the way he sang, all of these things were very, very profound. And they had a profound effect on the American musical scene.
What is in my paper, butches, how would it end? Ain't got a friend. My only sin is in my skin.
Lewis is really the tradition. We haven't caught up to it yet. He created our colloquialism. Every musician that I know of worth in popular music or jazz music is stung by Louis Armstrong.
In 1964, Louis Armstrong had the number one record in the nation. The success of Hello Dolly was a remarkable triumph for a man who'd revolutionized American music nearly 40 years earlier.
The room swaying, the band playing. Old favorite tune from way back when, yes. Take a rap, fellas, land on an empty lap, yes.
When Louis Armstrong was growing up, the word jazz was unknown. A new brass band music, rich in rhythm and soaked in the blues, had taken root in his hometown of New Orleans. But it took his genius, conquering poverty, racism, and indifference, to turn it into America's most durable and original musical art. Before the world knew Armstrong as Ambassador Satch, before he entertained audiences with his clowning and mugging, he had set the ground rules for the way we hear and play jazz and popular music.
He turned jazz into an individual improvisation that didn't break away from the backing and the ensemble, but set the spotlight on one person. The effect, obviously, is still seen today.
During the mid-1920s in Chicago, Armstrong embarked on a project that codified the art of jazz improvisation. He organized small recording units known variously as the Hot Five and Hot Seven, which made 65 records in 3 years. Had he stopped performing in 1929, Armstrong would never have become the world-famous ambassador of goodwill, but he'd still have a claim on history as the man who created the foundation for a new music. 60 years later, his early records with their colorful titles continue to astonish and delight.
Potato Head Blues, where Pop says, di-di-di-do-di-di-di. Now, he begins a lot of his solos with that. Di-di-di-do-di-di. And that's something that King Oliver played all the time. And maybe some other New Orleans trumpet players played it all the time. But to me, that's like a call do. Di-di-di-bo-di-bo-di-bo-bo-do-wee-o-bo-be. Di-da-do-do-do-wee-da. Do-do-do-di-bi-da-bo-wee-ya. Di-do-bo-do-bo-wee-bo-be. Bo-do-bo-do-bo-do-bo-do-bo-wee-b. In Armstrong's playing, it's always that underpinning of a deep, pensive, and intellectual quality, which is manifest in his more difficult solo, something like West End Blues, where he does take a lot of harmonic chances and plays a lot of difficult things.
West End Blues, that's a wonderful one. I'd like to have a dollar for every trumpet player that's goofed copying Louis' intro. That's a formidable beginning that he does. The notes aren't that complex. What makes it hard is he starts on a very high note, and the rhythm. Louis was very strong on rhythm, and the way he breaks up the phrase is, it's very awkward to try to copy it.
Was a new kind of artist, cagey and direct, inspiring and crude, high and low. In these records, a new music was etched into the grooves of a new technology, capturing for all time the purity of Armstrong's sound and his impetuous spirit.
You couldn't buy his records when they first came out. No one could. They were selling like hotcakes. You couldn't buy them. You couldn't buy them in any store. They were selling just like all the stores were that sold records. Even grocery stores were selling his records. And you're lucky to get. You were very lucky to find one of Louis Armstrong's records back then in those days.
Armstrong was a born showman who could light up any stage with his dazzling confidence and wit. In one of his earliest films, a short subject rife with appalling stereotypes, he stood ankle-deep in soap bubbles, wearing a leopard skin, singing a minstrel song. He transcended it all. As a truly free man who could make offensive material serve his own ends, he became a hero to the black community.
Oh, chocolate drop, that's me, girl. My hair is curly, just because my teeth are burning. Oh, just begun. I always wear a smile. I like to dress up in the ladies' style, ladies' style. Just because I'm glad I'm living. Oh, I take all my troubles, all with a smile. Just because my color shade makes different men. That's why they call me shine.
Just a trumpet virtuoso improvising flights of lasting power, he had become an irresistible performer, the only musician ever to influence the music of his time equally as singer and instrumentalist.
Oh, well, his singing was wonderful. And not only that, he was what we call the scat singer. Louis was the first one to do that. Now, he was on a record date once, and he was holding up a sheet of music to read the words to the song, dropped the sheet of music, and he didn't want to ruin the record, so he went on to sing. Re-bop, de-bop, de-bop, be-boom, you know, scat singer.
One tune there that heebie-jeebies where I drop the paper and start scatting, because we used to do that in the quartets in New Orleans, you know? Sound like an instrument or something.
Armstrong singing and scatting was something new to Chicago, the people in the public in Chicago. But that's an old New Orleans way of entertaining that was done in New Orleans way before. I imagine Louis was doing that in Chicago, I mean in New Orleans, because that's really New Orleans' way of singing, scatting, and they're still doing that down there. And well, this was sort of new. Well, Louis was a creating. He was creating so much.
His beginnings could not have been less promising. Abandoned by his father at birth, Louis was brought up in a red light section of New Orleans so riddled with vice and violence, it was known as the battlefield. All that remains of Jane Alley today is a tree, protected by a brick wall around which the modern city of New Orleans has sprung up. He always insisted he was a child of the American century, born July 4th, 1900. In truth, he was born August 4th, 1901, as shown by the baptismal registry of the Sacred Heart of Jesus Church. His mother, May Ann, was devoted to Louis and to his younger sister, Beatrice. Occasionally, May Ann took her children out of New Orleans to the sugarcane fields of Boutte, 70 miles west of the city, where her family had once worked on the plantations and where they enjoyed a sense of community that would stand Louis in good stead for the rest of his life, as Armstrong later recalled.
One thing about May Ann, everybody from the church folks to the lowest gave her the greatest respect. She never envied no one or anything they might have. I guess I inherited that part of life from May Ann.
All his life, Armstrong would write, talk, and sing about the joys and horrors of growing up in New Orleans.
You hear those banjos ringing, the darkest thing over. And this grand silly break of day. Give those Southlands where the dream is on. Take me back where I belong. Right in my mammy's arms. When it's sleepy time dies out.
Louis was reduced to stealing from produce barrels to help put food on the table. His future seems circumscribed from birth by racism and poverty. But even as a small boy, his irrepressible personality made him friends. A neighboring Jewish family put him to work with their sons, selling coal to the prostitutes in Storyville. They brought him home for dinner and taught him to sing lullabies from the heart. And they enabled him to buy his first cornet. He taught himself the blues, but he hungered for lessons.
It either was a New Year's or a Christmas one. Everybody was shooting firecrackers. Louis got a gun and shot. And instead of lighting a firecracker, Louis, pow, 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 pow. And so they put him in at home. When he got in there, they had a music teacher in there. That's where Louis learned how to play the trumpet.
The Colored Waif's Home was founded by legendary Southern educator Captain Joseph Jones. Its music professor soon recognized a prodigious talent in young Louis.
There was a teacher there by the name of Mr. Peter Davis. It was for a long time before he'd even look at me, you know what I mean? Because from the neighborhood I came from, he figured I was one of them bad boys too, you see? Mm-hmm. So anyhow, one day Mr. Peter Davis come and he made me the bugler of the institution and showed me how to blow the bugle and watching Joe lift the horn and different thing, and I made all the calls. When I got out, I went right into Joe Oliver. So quite naturally, he was in my life. I used to run errands for his wife, Miss Stella Oliver, and Joe would give me lessons, and I was always there when she gave me his red beans and rice.
I think the reason that Louis Armstrong really loved New Orleans is that when he was growing up in New Orleans, it afforded him all of the experiences that one could want if you were going to be an artist. He could come in contact with people from all walks of life and have an exchange with them. And then there was opera in New Orleans and a hierarchy of older musicians who looked out for the younger musicians and made sure that they would practice.
In 1918, 17-year-old Louis began to claim he was a year older. That was the year King Oliver left for Chicago, and Louis was chosen to replace him in the city's hottest band. He played in the talks, in street parades, and at picnics at the posh lakeside resort known as the West End. He also married a prostitute and legally adopted a retarded cousin he would take care of all his life. He began playing on the Mississippi riverboats under the tutelage of Fate Marable. At every stop along the way, Marable drew crowds by playing the calliope on the upper deck. Armstrong's reputation spread as far north as Davenport, Iowa, as young musicians, including Bix Beiderbecke, heard him play on the steamer. Soon, King Oliver wired him to come to Chicago.
I just had left the excursion boats. I went in there in 1919, then I played with Kid Ory, and then around 1922, I was playing with the Tuxedo Brass Band, Celestan. And then that's when King Oliver sent for me to play second trumpet with him at the Lincoln Gardens.
And you were surprised?
Well, I was surprised. I was happy. Couldn't nobody else get me out of New Orleans?
Chicago was a hotbed of jazz in those days. We had this great black exodus from the South coming to Chicago for a better way of life, and they needed all this unskilled black labor, porters and red caps and all this sort of stuff. So we had all of these black people coming there, and after they got there and got a good way of life, they sent down South for their entertainment. And that's when King Oliver and General Morton and all these guys came there, and I got to see them.
When Armstrong arrived at the Lincoln Gardens in Chicago and heard King Oliver's Creole jazz band for the first time, his first thought was to turn around and go home. He simply wouldn't be good enough. In truth, the young man almost immediately surpassed all the others. At Oliver's first recording session, Armstrong was asked to stand 20 feet behind the other musicians so as not to overwhelm them.
Louis was playing the second parts to King's lead. And they would play breaks in things that were incredible. Louis would play the perfect harmony to the second part and anticipate what King was going to play. And then King would put a handkerchief over his right playing hand to see if he could fool the great Louis.
I put notes to his lead, whatever he made. We didn't write it.
Did you rehearse it?
No, just for the moment. You can tell me. You tell me while the band is playing. What are you going to play on that? What is this? I pick out my notes.
So you give
and
you
that's
cue.
Why all the musicians used to come around to hear us do that, you know? So there was no secret lad.
I can see where Lou was influenced by Joe Alba, because Joe Alba played just the same style of Louis Armstrong. He didn't, he wasn't as strong as Louis, because he was a very soft, quiet trumpet player. But he, the same thing that Oliver played, Louis played, the same style.
Louis's dynamic presence could not be contained for long. One night in Chicago, he saw a different kind of artist who inspired him to press further into the realm of entertainment.
Bill Bojangles Robinson was the greatest. He didn't need blackface to be funny. He represented comedy plus danger in my race. He was immaculately dressed and funny, and the audience loved him. That's what counted. His material is what counted. Wow, I was sold on him ever since.
While playing in Oliver's band, Louis fell in love with the group's pianist. Lil Hardin became the second Mrs. Armstrong.
Lil was the belle of the Windy City at that time. Who was I to think that a big, high-powered chick like Lil Hardin, who came to Chicago from Memphis right out of Fisk University, valedictorian of her class, would get stuck on me? I just couldn't conceive the idea.
Lil convinced Louis to leave Oliver's band and take an offer from band leader Fletcher Henderson in New York. Louis influenced the playing styles of every major jazz musician on the East Coast. They admired his projection and authority, his perfect time, his profound understanding of the blues. He became the favorite accompanist of all the great blues divas, including Ma Rainey and Bessie Smith. When he came back home to Chicago a year later, banners were out to proclaim his return.
Everywhere he went after he left New Orleans, somebody was sending for him to come and play. King Oliver sent for him, Fletcher Henderson sent for him, and everybody sent for him. And whenever he came, a transformation took place, and it was always people imitating him.
I went with so many different organizations. I went with Fiskin Tate at the Vendome at that time. And as you go along, you know, you're changing the styles. And there's playing for silent pictures, big old symphony orchestra playing for silent pictures. And after the curtain go up, you play overture and hot number. That's where I came in, you know.
Whenever Louis would play, stand up and play that solo in the Vendome, the people would start screaming. You couldn't hear Louis, what he was playing for, a few bars, because the people were screaming at, wanted him. And just, you know, that light hit him and he was beautiful standing up there.
While thrilling the crowds at the Vendome, Louis romanced the beautiful Alpha Smith, the third Mrs. Armstrong, and recorded the Hot Fives and Hot Sevens. Few musicians could match him back then. One who came close was his recording partner, pianist Earl Hines, whose single-note phrases and powerful octaves were dubbed trumpet-style piano.
I never thought that I'd run across anybody who had the style that I would like to play if I was going to play trumpet. So I used it on the piano. That's why they call it trumpet-style piano. So when I ran across Louis and we started working together, he'd steal something from me and say, thank you. I'd steal something from you and say, thank you. That's where we went wrong.
Louis's record swept the world, planting the seeds from which the swing era would soon emerge. In 1929, Louis was beckoned once again to New York. This time, he would become a major star. At Connie's Inn in Harlem, he sang and played Fats Waller's Ain't Misbehavin' so successfully that his performance was inserted into the Broadway production Hot Chocolates.
His first big pop hit was Ain't Misbehavin' when he played in the pit band of Connie's Hot Chocolates, and he got up and he did a solo. And that's the first time the commercial world really found out about Louis Armstrong.
Now from the land where blues were born comes a man and a horn.
15 years later, he would be invited to recreate that triumph opposite Dorothy Dandridge in the movie Atlantic City.
The man with the horn.
no one to talk with, all by myself, no one to walk with, I'm happy on the shelf. And misbehaving saved my love. Oh, baby, do that. No forsaking the one I love. And through it plaining, you that I'm thinking of. And misbehaving saved my love. Like Jack Horner in a corner, don't go nowhere, and I don't care. All your kisses are worth waiting for, believe me. I don't stay out late, leave Jen alone. I'm home about 8, just me and my gramophone. Ain't misbehaving, save my love.
In 1930, Lewis went to Los Angeles and headlined at Sebastian's Cotton Club, where he won the admiration of numerous Hollywood stars. The trip ended in calamity, however, when he was arrested for smoking marijuana in his car with a white musician between sets. A shady manager from Chicago had his sentence reduced to a few weekends in jail, but Armstrong, who called pot an insulator against the pain of racism, continued to smoke it all his life.
Every night, on intermissions, I would, you know, go out and roll up a couple of joints of good Mexican grass. So, you know, Alvin Pops was out there, you know, and he would come out with what he would call his New Orleans Golden Leaf, which is very, very sad. It was terrible. Did nothing. You know, so. Funny thing happened when, you know, after a couple of weeks I noticed, you know, every time I was at a mission, I'd go outside, you know, and Pops would be there, you know, sitting on the garden wall or on the tree, whatever we had available. And so finally one night I asked him, I said, Pops, I said, listen, you know, I noticed the last couple of weeks you don't come out with your New Orleans Golden Leaf anymore, you know. He said, sure, son. It's like bringing a hamburger to a banquet.
You could really tell when Pops was high. Pops was really blow. And especially when he come back off intermission. When he come off intermission, Pops be ready.
Oh, but I'm ready. I'm ready.
He says, I'm ready, I'm ready, so help me, I'm ready. And when he said that, the folks rest rolled and the band laughed too. And he was ready. Pops was really ready.
Mm-hmm. Armstrong was now fronting a big band directed for him by Zilner Randolph. Back in Chicago, he discovered that the incident in Los Angeles had unexpected repercussions. Two managers, each affiliated with different gangsters, were warring over his contract.
One night, this big bad-ass hood crashed my dressing room at the Showboat in Chicago and told me I had to be in New York the next night. I told him I got the Chicago engagement and don't plan no traveling. Then he flashed a pistol at me and cocked it. I said, well, maybe I am going to New York.
But Armstrong and his band escaped Chicago that night. He would stay on the run for 4 years, performing in Europe and in much of the United States, but not in Chicago or New York. During a visit to New Jersey, he guest starred in a Betty Boop cartoon.
I'll be glad when you get rest of you. before I brought you to my home, you would leave my wife alone. I'd be glad when the day that I you. Now, I'll be glad when the day that I you. I'll be tickled to death when you leave this old dear dog. I took you for my friend, where you put me in the back for the sin. You ain't no good, you rascal, you. Look at that. Yeah! All right, yeah. You're right, little dog. I tell you, you was a butter boy.
While still on the run, he made his first professional visit to New Orleans in 9 years. The prodigal son returned to the Waif's home, now known as the Municipal Boys Home. He learned that a local baseball team had been named after him. Despite all the acclaim, a white announcer refused to introduce him on the radio. Lewis shrugged off the insult and introduced himself. When he learned that blacks would not be allowed to attend his performances, he promised to return and play exclusively for them. He fulfilled his promise with an appearance at the Golden Dragon a few years later. Europe was hungry for his presence. On arriving in England, he was crowned with a permanent new nickname. As a boy, friends had tagged him with various monikers to describe his large mouth, among them Satchel Mouth. An editor who had misheard it greeted him with a shortened version. Among fellow artists, Armstrong was already known as Pops, but from then on, millions of fans around the world would know him as Satchmo. When Satchmo arrived in Denmark, 10,000 people met his railway carriage. The Danes also had the prescience to film him in performance.
Now, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Armstrong. The next number we're going to swing for you is one of the good old favorites. That's Dinah, Dinah. Look out there, boss. Are you ready? Look out. Anyone finer in the state of Carolina? If there is, then you know, sure to me, Dinah. The dick not pleasant, who love the city's gazing to the eyes of Dinah Lee. Baby, every night, one eye, shake with fine arm. Cut my dynamite, change your mind. Baba, did you want it? Did you want it? Did you want it, baby? I'd have a new line. Oh, baby. Oh, Dinah. Dinah. Oh,
Returned to the U.S. in 1935, he was free of the mobs, but his career was at ebb tide. All those strenuous high notes had badly injured his lip. Though the swing era was about to blossom, inspired by his rhythms and riffs, he had neither a band nor a record contract. In Chicago, he renewed his friendship with Joe Glazer, the man Lewis later credited with taking him to unprecedented heights.
I did a command performance with him for Prince Philip. And he was so grateful, he invited
Louis Armstrong and myself to Buckingham Palace. And here I am sitting with Prince Philip and Louis Armstrong. So, of course, he was very curious. Prince Philip said, tell me what it was like in New Orleans in those days. So he said, well, he said, it was kind of rough. He said, there were a lot of tough guys, and I wanted to get out of there. He says, I wanted to become famous. So he says, the big racketeer, he said, this one big black guy, he said, had a gun in his waist there. And he said, and I said, how do you get out of New Orleans and become famous? He said, well, you have to become some white man's nigger. And when he said that, Prince Philip went over the couch. You know, he couldn't believe that he said that. And when he went over the couch, he looked at me, he says, and that's when I got Joe Glazer.
Joe Glazer. Well, that's a kind of a strange situation, because Joe, as everybody knows, was running the Lincoln Gardens in Chicago for, they say, Al Capone, no reason to doubt it. And he was a rough and tumble guy. But he loved Louis and took good care of him. And Joe, at the same time, was so conscious of using Louis's talents to make money that I think Louis was blocked off in some directions that he could have gone in, which would have been musically more interesting.
Glazer's connections and his devotion to Louis helped him knock down doors previously closed to black performers. Louis was one of the first blacks to get featured in top Hollywood movies.
Okay, Martin, let's have Louis Armstrong.
Oh, I can't give you anything but love. Baby, that's the only thing I've plenty of. Baby, dream a while, scheme a while. You should find, happiness. And I guess all those things you crying for, baby. Gee, I'd like to see you looking swell. Baby, diamond bracelets, Woolworth doesn't sell. Oh, baby, doo-doo, tell that lucky day, you know darn well, baby, I can't give you thing but love.
Great actor, but because of his the bigotry at that time, the big accent on white artists rather than black, they kind of just used him, you know, in the Bing Crosby pictures or anything. And he'd save the movies. I mean, I remember when he came on the screen, everybody go, oh, there's Louis Armstrong. You know, the whole movie would lift up. And he was really a great actor, but he wasn't categorized as an actor.
There's an old deserted mansion on an old forgotten road where the better ghosts and goblins always hang out. One night they threw a party in a manner a la mode, and they cordially invited all the gang out. At a dark, bewitching hour, when the fun was loud and hearty, a a notorious wallflower. He came to life of the party. The spooks were having their midnight fling. Mary Megan was in full swing. They shrieked themselves into a cheerful trance. When the skeleton in the closet started to dance.
Armstrong's drummer was Lionel Hampton. Armstrong seemed to be taking over from the old. He'd even surpassed Bill Robinson as a full-fledged celebrity. Among other achievements, Satchmo was the first black performer sponsored on network radio. The personality behind his artistry proved riveting, no matter how insulting the context.
What kind of a place is this? An insane asylum for horses?
Hey, Uncle Tom, in case you don't know it, your horse is running away.
Yes, sir. I knows it.
Then you better stop jamming and get after him.
That's just what I'm gonna do, mister.
Oh, jeepers, creepers, where'd you get those peepers? Jeepers, creepers, where'd you get those eyes? Oh, gosh, all get up. I'd get so lit up. Gosh, all get up. I'd get that size. Oh, golly gee. When you turn the heaters on, woe is me. Got to put my cheetahs on. Jeepers, creepers, where'd you get those peepers? All those weepers have hypnotized.
Yeah.
Where'd you get those eyes,
Gate?
Where'd you get those eyes,
Seth?
Where'd you get those eyes? Papa, didn't do that. Yeah, there's eyes.
It was in one of New York's nightclubs in 1938 that he met the love of his life, a young dancer named Lucille Wilson.
It seemed to me that Lucille was the ideal girl for me. We both had good common sense and were great observers of people. But we didn't have, well, we did without. One night when we were both working at the Cotton Club, I said to Lucille, I might as well tell you right now, I have eyes for you. And if any of these cats in the show are shooting for you, well, I want to be in the running. Lucille looked at me and laughed. Before we knew it, we were taking in shows between our shows and riding uptown in Harlem every night.
We took Lucille back on her job. She was dancing at the Lafayette Theater. And right after he kissed her goodbye at the door, he did a little whirl and came literally dancing back to the car. It was wonderful to see. It was like a little boy. He did a pirouette, waving his arms as he did so, and his eyes were flashing, and he said, oh, that's my girl, that's my girl. And it crossed my mind at the time that Louis was still married. So I realized that that marriage was breaking up. Everybody knew it. And I wasn't surprised to find that he married Lucille shortly after. And you know, Lucille was perhaps the greatest thing that ever happened to Louis outside of anything in music.
Yes, I'm keeping out of mischief now. Really am in love somehow. I'm through playing with fire. It's you whom I desire. All the world can plainly see.
In 1943, Lucille surprised Louis by purchasing and decorating a house in Corona, Queens. When Louis, accustomed to living in hotels, came in off the road to see it for the first time, He was so apprehensive, he asked the cab driver to wait outside. When he saw the care Lucille had taken, he was pleased indeed. He asked the driver in for dinner.
Dick Cavett says to him, you know, you're a very wealthy man. You're quite well known. You're a legend. You're known the world over. But you still live in Corona. How come? He said, well, that's my home. He said, but I mean, after all, a man of your wealth can live any way he wants to. He said, I don't want to live anywhere else. He says, that's where I live and that's my home. He said, well, what about the surrounding area? Don't you worry about people looting your home? And he says, no, man. They take care of my house. They say, hey, man, get away from there. That's Louis's house.
It seems so much smaller always when I come here than yeah, when he was in it. It seemed bigger when he was in it.
It was.
This really is Lucille's house. I mean, the decorations, it's all nicely done and well-furnished and all that. But I always consider her Lady Armstrong. You know, Pops was Pops, as I said. Very comfortable, down-home guy, you know, grew up in the ghetto. But she was Lady Armstrong.
Money meant nothing to Louis Armstrong. Anyone with the kind of money that Louis had would have had a whole estate someplace. But he chose to stay right here in this neighborhood with the people in this neighborhood and his kids. And when he would load that bus up, and the kids would come around, ice cream man would come through here and he'd call them my little ice cream eaters.
The music scene was changing once again in the mid-40s as a new breed of jazz musician came on the scene. Louis could always spot talent.
One night after the set, someone came over to me and said, say something. I really like that sound you get, you know. And I looked up and it was Louis. So I said, you know, thank you. Thank you very much, you know. It's a great honor.
Dexter Gordon joined Armstrong's band in 1944. Within 2 years, he would emerge as a major figure in the modern jazz movement, pioneered by Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie. The premier figures in bop were avowed Armstrong admirers, but their radical ideas set off a firestorm of controversy, and Louis got caught up in it as young fans branded him old-fashioned.
Those styles of Charlie Parker and Dizzy, don't think that they're not good musicians. They played like everybody else in those days, but during the jam sessions, these riffs are coming out.
Mm-hmm.
Say, now you might be sitting there, you're a businessman. Say, well, we can take these riffs and call it a style. At least make a lot of money. Wish they did. I don't know where the boppers got it. They still walk around and do a little hot water bottle.
They didn't record him until 1944 on my first trip to California. It was a disappointing session for me. Here I was going to record my champ, and the band came in from off the road. They had been doing army camps, and they were exhausted. They came in on the bus, and we only got in three sides, which was unheard of in those days. I never got what I really wanted to out of the band.
Armstrong's band was in decline as entertainment values eclipsed musical ones. Yet Louis continued to influence younger musicians, especially singers.
Billie Holiday, if you listen real close, even though it's feminine and it's Billie Holiday, if you listen real close, it's Louis Armstrong's phrasing. And it's very interesting, you know, you hear Billie, and as much as you love Billie as you're listening, if you listen real hard, you'll hear a ba-da-da-da. You know, it's Louis. You could hear Louis in there.
His singing opened the door for Bing Crosby, Billie Holiday, Nat Cole. All of these singers are like his children.
When the moon's kind of dreamy, starry-eyed and dreamy, and nights are luscious and long, if you're kind of lonely and all by your only, then nothing but the blues are brewing. The blues are brewing.
The success of the movie New Orleans encouraged Lewis to scale down the orchestra to a traditional New Orleans lineup, made up of some of the greatest names in jazz, including his partner from the Hot 5 years, Earl Hines, trombonist Jack Teagarden, clarinetist Barney Bigard, bassist Arvel Shaw, drummer Sid Catlett. And the rotund comedian, Velma Middleton.
Yes, she used to do the splits, and I'd always say to myself, some nights she ain't gonna make it. But that was funny, and the audience cracked up. A big woman about 250 to 300 pounds, falling on the floor, spreading her legs out. I said, oh God, I hope she makes it. I used to say that every show. She always did.
Joe Glazer decided to book Louis into a club in Hollywood called Billy Berg's as a tryout. And we opened Billy Berg's, and it was such a, just a sensation. You won't believe, because it seems like everybody on earth had been waiting for Louis to get back to playing the type of music that made him famous.
Oh, Rockin' Jim got me good.
Oh, Rockin' Jim got me good.
Came by my side,
and you came by your side.
Fetch me some water, son.
You know you don't drink water, brother.
Boy, then you're
my hide's already tan.
Can't get from this gavel, oh.
What Kevin choking, mother?
Ain't go nowhere.
You ain't going nowhere, yeah.
Just sitting here grabbing.
Grabbing.
At the blood round my rocking chair.
Rocking chair.
I remember dear old Aunt Harriet.
I remember old Aunt Harriet.
How long in heaven she be.
Oh, about a year and a half, Daddy.
Send me a sweet chariot and
oh, yeah, that's it.
For the end of the trouble I see.
My sweet chariot.
One day when I was playing on the riverboats, we put into New Orleans, and standing on the levee was a tall white cat named Jack Teagarden, wanting to meet me. He was from Texas, and I'd never heard of him. But he said, you a spade, and I'm an old fay. We got the same soul. Let's blow. And that's the way it was. When he joined my band years later, it was like a holiday. We understood each other so wonderful.
Looks like old Rockin' Chair got you, Daddy.
I can't move a peg, boy.
Louis Armstrong and the All-Stars, as all his groups would henceforth be known, was the highest-paid band in jazz. The bop wars were soon forgotten, and when Louis finally encountered Dizzy on TV, the two great showmen turned a trite tune into a battle of wits.
Better. It looks like rain.
Louis's popularity soared. The All-Stars played a grueling regimen of one-nighters all over the world, occasionally coming to rest for an extended nightclub appearance. Louis appeared in 11 movies in the 1950s alone, and he was a ubiquitous favorite on radio and television. In high society, Armstrong renewed his association with Bing Crosby.
Well, you take some skin, jazz begins. And you take a bass. Man, now we're getting someplace. Take a box, one that rocks. Take a blue horn, New Orleans bar.
Bing kind of did a very swinging but white Louis Armstrong, you know, Bing was always relaxed. He arrived at being relaxed. And he was cool, and Louis was hot. That's how Bing arrived at this wonderful pipe in the mouth and let's go fishing and let's play golf and cool it, you know. But he learned all that. He loved jazz and was a great, ended up being a great musicologist. And he knew Louis Armstrong's worth right from the beginning. He's a pop singer who loved jazz.
A year later, Louis and Bing reprised their number from High Society on TV.
Hey, Pops, you want to come up here and take a little, leave a little?
Yeah.
If you sail,
I sail it, sail it.
Over the sea,
and will you wait for me?
Take my tip, they're all moto hip in Italy.
Well, I rent the chair, as for friends.
Oh, they zig the beat?
Yes, believe it or not.
I do believe, I do indeed.
All the people what they call leeches.
Ah, for me, Duff, take a plane.
Oh, my this.
Go to Siam.
Bye,
in Bangkok today, round the clock, oh, will they all like to jam? Indian song. The Amazon.
Yes.
Take one bar, and all of them are.
Well, gone, gone.
Up the equator. Up to the pole. Everybody wing and ring ding ding a ling and that rock, 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 rock and roll. From the north to the south, east to the west. Jazz is king, jazz is the thing that folks dig best.
Oh, the shark has pretty teeth, dear.
Louis's visibility was sustained in the 1950s by such hit records as I Get Ideas, Blueberry Hill, and Mac the Knife. When he sang Mac the Knife with Lottie Lenya, for whom it was written, he said its characters reminded him of the honky-tonk denizens he'd known in New Orleans. As the All-Stars continued to play one-nighters before millions of fans, Joe Glazer began promoting him as Ambassador Satch.
Because it's all so good. Yes, it's the bomb. I'll say it to you, like the French people do. Baby, it's so good. Every way, every smile, every kiss there. Lacey was, they want style. And it's me.
Lewis's role as ambassador of goodwill was solidified in 1956 when he made his first tour of West Africa. In Accra, he was greeted by more than 100,000 people.
When we went to Africa, they picked us up and carried us. They were so happy to see us, they carried us.
In Ghana, Lewis performed Fats Waller's Black and Blue, which he had established as a protest song back in 1929.
This next one on the Prime Minister, Black and Blue. Cold empty bed, spring's heart is laid, feel like golden air, wished I was dead. What did I do? Be so black and blue. Even the mouse ran from my house. They laugh at you and scorn you too. What did I do to be so black and blue? I'm white inside. That don't help my case. Cause I can't hide what is in my face. For fortune, fortune, by the way, I would it in. Ain't got a friend. My only sin is in my skin. To be so black and blue.
You going to Russia?
I'm Russian. That's just as fast as they can send me. I mean, after all, my public is the same all over the world.
They play for all the countries and all languages. They know I don't speak with one language that's bad English. But still and all, they know the music's gonna be great. So the government is thinking about sending me into Russia. And if we ever get... Let me tell you an incident, Mr. Monroe. In 53, I played Berlin. And I can't count the Russians that came through the Iron Curtain to hear our Louis. That's the way they expressed it when we all met at the Hot Club. They stood up and said it was a pleasure to take the chance to hear our Louis. And anybody say that the Russians don't love good jazz, you send them to me, you know?
But Lewis never made it to Russia. Incidents in the American South would cause him to cancel a proposed State Department tour of the Soviet Union. Armstrong had lived with racism all his life, and its wounds were deep.
It used to upset me, and I couldn't get Zooty Singleton to bring him to my jam sessions on 52nd Street at Jimmy Ryan's, but Louis wouldn't come down with his wife to a nightclub on 52nd Street. Evidently, he had been hurt in his early years by not being allowed in restaurants or in theaters, maybe, and I had to use the musician's entrance, or you know, the delivery entrance of hotels and all. And he was above it. He didn't want to feel the hurt again, So he didn't come downtown. He would come downtown to work and then go home.
In 1957, Armstrong played in Knoxville, Tennessee before a segregated audience of 8,000 whites and 1,000 blacks. A stick of dynamite was thrown at the auditorium from a passing car.
We were on the stage then, Gary, and somebody run up on the stage and said there was a bomb went off. And Louis said, where? He said, next door. They said you could put the bus in the hole. It was so big.
Louis, we understand that when the fireworks went off in Knoxville last night, you made a comment which was quoted in the press to the effect, don't worry, folks, that was just a telephone. How about the rest of your southern tour? We have in mind King Cole's experience in Birmingham. Just what is your attitude going to be if further incidents of this sort?
I should pay attention to that. All I want to do is blow the horn. And I'm from New Orleans, a southern boy. I mean, I shouldn't be afraid of anything or excited. I mean, the people all seem to enjoy our music from the first note on. We was having a wonderful time.
up until then and after that.
On September 19, 1957, Armstrong heard about the battle in Little Rock. Black school children had been refused admission to the public schools. He exploded.
He made a statement in an interview. He said President Eisenhower should go down there and take those little children by the hand and lead them into that school. Now, Joe Glazer immediately called Louis Armstrong in Fargo and said, you couldn't have said that, Louis. And he said to the press, Louis wouldn't say that. He didn't say that. And Louis said, yes, I did.
Armstrong caused a firestorm. A columnist for a New York paper demanded a boycott of his appearances. Concerts were canceled in the South. Only after Eisenhower took a stand did Armstrong apologize in a telegram that read,
if you decide to walk into school with the little colored kids, take me along, Daddy. God bless you.
Yet by then, accusations of communist had mounted, and Lewis's activities were secretly monitored by the FBI for the rest of his life.
Louis felt things much stronger than certainly Joe Glazer, his manager, even knew. And we thought, again, about the idea for Louis being the correct and the only person to do real ambassador.
The real spokesman for that time.
Remember who you are and what you represent. Always be a credit to your government. No matter what you say or what you do, the eyes of the world are watching you.
The oneness of man and the divisions of race being so stupid and unnecessary. But we tried to put it in a musical and light form that would draw people into it. And I think that Louis Armstrong epitomized everything that we wanted to say.
Good God be black, my God.
In the image of God created he there.
If all are made in the image of thee.
Male and female created he there.
Could thou perchance a zebra be?
Now we had written that for a big laugh from the audience. But Louis delivered it almost in tears. And there's 5,000 people following him into a whole different emotion. And then I found, here's a side of Louis that I didn't know existed. And I don't think the audience really knew. They knew him for the person that was always full of joy and everything. But here he was so deep.
Oh, Lord, please hear my plea. Oh, give me eyes to see.
Inexplicably, Armstrong's courageous stand in the late 50s was greeted with accusations of tomming. The trademark Satchmo grin was misinterpreted. The criticism and the relentless travel took a toll. In 1959, while playing in Spoleto, he suffered a heart attack.
I guess they were in Italian. I guess that was the problem.
That's probably what it was. You couldn't read it right. They were saying I was feeling good, and you thought I was dying or something. But I had a private lawyer, so I came all the way from Rome. She spoke English, and she could read them charts right, and, you know.
By the way, how's your Italian?
Huh?
How is your Italian?
Oh, very good. Pizza.
Are you going to be getting any good food now? Are you well enough for that?
Oh, get the red beans and rice now, you know.
Well, I think Dr. Schiff said at one time that maybe you just blew yourself out for a while, didn't you, Doctor?
No, it ain't that. Sometime, you know, you just put a little grease on that Cadillac, it'll run another 500 miles.
Grab your hat, baby. Your worries down the doorstep. Just direct your feet on the sunny side.
So far as Louis Armstrong's playing in his later years, he's come under a lot of false criticism. Those who don't really understand what he was playing. they want him to play with the same type of velocity. See, a lot of times we confuse velocity with technique. Velocity is just the ability to play fast or jump octaves or something. The highest level of technique is nuance. So when you really are a master of technique is when you're when you don't have to play a pile of stuff and all of that is implied in what you play. And Louis Armstrong in this later period, I will tell you that these solos are virtually impossible to learn. Because first the nuance and the color of the tone is so refined and has been worked on for so many years. The rhythmic sophistication is so much more advanced than the earlier recordings.
Louis had never spent much time at home, but in the early 60s, illness forced him to slow down just a little. He and Lucille often entertained. One evening, they threw a party for clarinetist Peanuts Hucko and his wife to celebrate their wedding anniversary. He was never more relaxed than when surrounded by his family of musicians, including Trummy Young, Barney Bigard, and Louis Russell, whose big band Armstrong had fronted in the 1930s.
'Cause I'm blue, turning gray, over that you used to be.
He was 62 years old, and although he continued circling the globe, his career now seemed locked at an impasse. Times had changed. A president had been shot. The Beatles invaded. It seemed inconceivable that Louis could have any more surprises in store. He continued to do what he'd always done, in his own style, on his own terms.
Now you have your thrills in view.
Armstrong remained a sensual man. He liked to eat. He smoked too much. He drank in moderation, but he continued to indulge his beloved herbs, pot, and a product called Swiss Chris.
We went to a big royal dinner with everybody there, Princess Alexandra, the Kent, you know, the Duke, and all royalty with rubies and emeralds and diamonds. I couldn't believe what I was witnessing. I was sitting next to Princess Alexandra, and he was on the other side of Princess Alexandra, who's a beautiful lady. And he was talking to her and myself every once in a while. But then at the end of the meal, when the dessert came, she turned around to me. She said, "Did you ever try this?" And I looked at it, and it was his commercial product that he always advertised, Swiss Chris. And of course, it's a laxative, and a very ferocious laxative. I didn't know, I was at a loss for words. I didn't know what to say. And the Duke of Kent said, "What is it, my dear?" So he said, he starts handing it out to the royalty of England. He says, "Get it out." He says, "It's good for you." He said, "You get it all out. Get it all out." Well, when they read the instructions that it was a laxative, I never saw, it was like a barrel of white monkeys. I mean, everybody just fell on the floor, pounding the floor, It's the funniest thing I've actually seen. It was funnier than any Laurel and Hardy scene.
Armstrong's habit of handing out thousands of dollars to friends and fans down on their luck may have made Joe Glazer all the more determined to see him record another big hit. Neither of them thought much of a new song Lewis was asked to record one day in 1963. Lewis thought it was pretty lame and put it out of mind when he went back on the road.
We were out somewhere in the wilds of Iowa and Nebraska doing some one-nighters, you know, way out there, you know. So every night the audience would be calling, "Hello, Dolly, hello, Dolly." So Louis he ignored it for the first couple of nights. Every night it started getting loud, "Hello, Dolly, hello, Dolly." So Louis asked Billy Cow, said, "What's that, hello, Dolly?" So Billy said, "Hey, Pops, you remember that date we did in Chicago a few months ago? Well, one of the tunes is from a Broadway show. It's called Hello, Dolly." And the first time we put it in the concert, pandemonium broke out. So we were so far out in the woods, we didn't realize he had a hit record.
Well, hello.
Look who's here.
Dolly, this is Louis.
Hello, Louis.
Dolly, it's so nice to have you back where you belong.
I am so glad to be back.
Are you looking swell?
Thank you, Louis.
Dolly, I can tell.
Does it show?
Dolly, you still glowing. You still growing. You still
going strong.
I feel the room. And the band. One of our
favorite
songs.
It was my favorite.
Show some snap that find an empty love.
On February 15, 1964, it displaced the Beatles as the number one song in the country. No matter where he went, he couldn't escape it. Satchmo and Hello Dolly were everywhere.
I mean, I'm tired of playing it on the Victrola, on the hi-fi. Sing me Hello Dolly.
Hello, Dolly. This is Louis. Dolly. Mighty glad to be where you belong.
Right.
Yet to many, Armstrong seemed like a relic of a bygone age. People who'd forgotten how much he'd pioneered for black performers, not to mention his outspokenness on civil rights, which he continued into the 1960s, were embarrassed by his unembarrassed pleasure in playing music and entertaining.
A lot of people put Louis down. They said that what he was doing was Tommy. The true revolutionary is one that's not apparent. I mean, the true revolutionary is out waving a gun in the streets. It has never affected the police just to arrest them, but the police don't ever know about the guy that smiles and drops a little poison in their coffee. Well, Louis, in that sense, was that sort of revolutionary, a true revolutionary. He revolutionized the aspect of music as an art form, as a musician being a cultural leader.
I'll never forget during the 60s revolution, I was in Washington, D.C. on a black radio station, and I mentioned how I loved Louis Armstrong, and this defiant black announcer, you know, just said to me, "How dare you say that?" You know, intimating that he was Uncle Tom and he was insulting to his race. And I didn't care, I mean, what was gonna happen to me. I just said, look, I didn't get angry, but I just got so frustrated. I said, this is the greatest contributor of American music, you know, and it kind of cooled him out a little.
Look at your mama, someday you'll be sorry for bundles today. Papa don't say the way you treated me was wrong. Honey, I was the one who taught you all you know. Your little old friend said you to make me sing another song. Mama, good luck may be with you, Papa does it, Papa does not, and may your future you won't fear, dear. There won't be another to treat you like a brother. Broken record, take it from me, take it from me, take it from me, take it from me, take it from me.
Armstrong continued to barnstorm the world despite illness and frequent stays in hospital. He had been home for 2 months recovering from a heart attack when on July 5, 1971, he asked his doctor to bring the band together for rehearsal. It was time to go back to work. He died in bed the next morning.
I see trees of green, red roses too.
How many years are you going to be playing, Louis?
Well, musicians where I come from, they don't retire. They just stop with any more gigs.
What a wonderful world. I see skies of blue.
He was a friend of all people, all colors, all nations. When they say he was an ambassador of love, that's what he was. Ambassador of love.
What a wonderful world. In the sea, was the one I love soon come back to me.
Music has been created by different ethnic groups, but music is for everyone. True music is to be appreciated by the world citizens, period. And I think that the effect that he had on the black community was just as the same effect that he had on all the communities. So it's there. His influence is undeniable. It's unmistakable, and it's eternal.
Would you return? I cover the one sun. I'm watching the sea. Girl, the one I love will soon come back me.
It's really America's classical music. This becomes our tradition. The bottom line of any country in the world is, what did we contribute to the world? And we contributed Louis Armstrong.
He was a man of great majesty, and I just feel honored to be asked to speak about Louis Armstrong. And I just hope as many people as possible get hip to him, and it'll enrich your life to check Pops out, because boy, it certainly has enriched mine. I listen to all kind of music. From Bach, Palestrina, Wagner, I don't care. And Pops was bad.